I would like to sort of, within the conference, within our community, raise our heads from above our computer screens, our sheets of paper with full of calculations, and perhaps have a little pause to think about what the field is like, where it's heading, what are the big questions, and maybe get some inspiration from this. So this is the purpose of this. We also made it an open debate, an open event, so that people from outside could come and hear it, watch it, and experience firsthand what we in our field, physicists, cosmologists, astrophysicists, discuss, what are our big questions, what we are spending our taxpayers' money on. Is this something that is worth studying, or is this something that is completely useless? But also, beyond this sort of utilitarian approach, we feel as physicists, as scientists, that it's our duty to inform the general public about what we do and what comes out of it. So welcome to those who have come here from outside of the conference, especially for making an effort. And we hope you will not get lost once we start speaking, because physicists, once they start speaking, tend to quickly get into their jargon, technical jargon, which only they themselves think they understand, and the rest may get very discouraged. If that happens all too quickly, you are more than welcome to actually stop us and tell us, please tell us in layman's terms what you really mean, if you can. So please do that. So welcome to people from outside of the conference, and welcome to the people from the conference. Now, let me start by introducing the five panelists. And perhaps before I actually do it, I should introduce myself quickly. I will be moderating the discussion. I'm Leszek Roszkowski. I'm a professor at the National Center for Nuclear Research. And I'm a theorist, work in the area of particle physics, particle cosmology, particle astrophysics. My main concern or work area is dark matter and related areas of new physics. What does dark matter have to do with the Higgs boson that has been just discovered at the LHC recently, a few years ago, and things of this sort. But the panelists represent very diverse areas, and let me introduce them in turn, okay? Alphabetically. Stephen Barr is a professor of theoretical particle physics at the University of Delaware and director of the Bartol Research Institute at that university. He received his PhD from Princeton University in 1978, and in 2011 he was elected a fellow of the American Physical Society for his contributions to grand unified theories, the cosmology of the early universe, and theories of the asymmetry between matter and antimatter. He writes and lectures extensively on the relation of science and religion, and is the author of several books, including Modern Physics and Ancient Faith, which is an excellent book. Raphael Bousso, professor of physics at the University of California at Berkeley, is recognized for discovering the general relation between the curved geometry of space-time and its information content, known as the covariant entropy bound. This allowed for a precise and general formulation of the holographic principle, you may ask what that is, which is believed to underlie the unification of quantum theory and Einstein's theory of gravity. Raphael Bousso is also one of the discoverers of the landscape of string theory, which explains the small but non-vanishing value of the cosmological constant, or dark energy. His works led to a novel view of cosmology, the multiverse of string theory. Quite a lot, quite a load. Professor Kari Enqvist, at the end of the table, is a professor at the University of Finland, in Helsinki, obtained his PhD at the University of Helsinki in 1983. After holding postdoctoral positions at CERN in Geneva and the University of Wisconsin in Madison, he was an assistant professor at Nordita in, at that time, Copenhagen, right? Copenhagen. And then returned to Finland, where he is now a professor of cosmology. He began his career as a particle theorist, working on neutrino physics, supersymmetry, and superstring phenomenology before drifting to cosmology, where his main interest is inflation of model and models of the primordial perturbation. He's written 11 popular books on science and scientific worldview, all in Finnish, I understand. So we have to learn Finnish to read them, or else convince him to translate them into Polish or English. Katherine Freese is the director of the Nordic Institute for Theoretical Physics, which is Nordita, now in Stockholm, as well as George Uhlenbeck, professor of physics at the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, where the next COSMO meeting will be held, I'm reminding you. She works on a wide range of topics in theoretical cosmology and astroparticle physics. She has been working to identify the dark matter and dark energy that permeate the universe, as well as to build a successful model for the early universe immediately after the Big Bang. She is author of the book The Cosmic Cocktail, Three Parts Dark Matter, published in June 2014 by Princeton University Press. Her work has been described in popular media, including New York Times, and she has numerous appearances in radio and TV. She has been awarded an honorary doctorate, honoris causa doctorate, from the University of Stockholm in September 2012. She is a fellow of the American Physical Society, and she was awarded the Simons Foundation Fellowship in Theoretical Physics in 2012. Looks like the 2012 year was quite successful to you, Katie. Quite a lot of things. And finally, Juan Maldacena is a professor at the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton, New Jersey. He works on quantum field theory, quantum gravity, and string theory. He has also studied the application of string theory ideas to cosmology. He is particularly known for proposing a duality between quantum field theory and gravity, which relates gauge field strengths and quantum gravity. I'm reading the bios sent by the panelists, so maybe I should add here that this this duality is called the Maldacena conjecture in popular language, and it's received an enormous number of citations. Juan Maldacena was born in Buenos Aires, Argentina, in 1968. He graduated from the Instituto Balseiro in Argentina in 1991, and then received a doctorate from Princeton University in 1996. He was a professor at Harvard before joining the Institute in 2001. So these are the panelists. And as you can see, they represent a very wide range of areas. Now, let me make a comment that I would love to see many more people on the panel, even if only senior people who are supposed to know more and share their wisdom would be allowed. Even then, the panel would just become way too big. So I hope that several of you, more senior and more junior, will actually join the discussion and contribute to it. Do not feel that since you are on the other side, you can only listen. Quite the opposite. We do expect a very sort of lively discussion. Also, some people were supposed to be here and couldn't. Hitoshi Murayama was supposed to be here and also represents, in some sense, Asia, and we couldn't, he couldn't come. So please sort of treat it as a joint event and not the event where you would be just listening. I should also mention that the event is being recorded by the John Paul II Center for Interdisciplinary Studies in Krakow. It was set up by Professor Reverend Michał Heller from the funds that he received as his Templeton Prize years back, a few years ago. Now, a technical thing that we set up, set out time until 10 o'clock for the event to last, but not quite. We are not quite sure if we can last that long if we discuss it, and if we can, you can last. So we'll probably finish earlier, but we'll see how things go. So let's start. But before, let me just ask one question: how many of you are hesitant to point fingers? How many of you are physicists? Let's put it this way. So I can see that some, quite a few, are non-physicists. Still welcome to you know, here. And as I said, if things become too technical, please just tell us, and we'll try to correct ourselves. Okay. I think I should, at this point, sit down and join the panel. And we should get your microphones ready. They are on. Okay, very good. So, what inspired me to sort of think about organizing this discussion is that, in my opinion, my humble opinion, the field of particle physics and also the field of cosmology, which I believe are related, has really gone through a sort of roller coaster over the last 100 years, and certainly the last decades. And in fact, the title of this discussion is Modern Physics, and I mean those areas of modern physics, is modern physics perhaps even crossing the boundaries of science? But let's first start by perhaps asking all the panel members to tell us what, in their opinion, are the most important results or discoveries or ideas in the last few decades in the field, in the broadly understood field of particle physics and cosmology. Let's start in turn.
Okay, I think an incredibly important result was in 1998 when physicists discovered, astronomers discovered that the universe is accelerating its expansion. So we used to think that while the universe is expanding, it's sort of doing that in a slower and slower way. But it turned out that, in fact, it started pressing the gas pedal a few billion years ago and expanding faster and faster. That was for a number of reasons that I won't get into unless we come back to it. I think an incredibly profound experimental discovery. But I mean, saying that should get a Nobel Prize is an understatement, right? There are lots of things that get Nobel Prizes. Another, I think, very important discovery is in fact the lack of any new particles at the LHC so far. If that holds up, that might still change. So the LHC is this big particle detector near Geneva. And it found the one particle that it had to find. We knew it had to be there, called the Higgs. But the idea was that it was going to find a bunch of other particles that would explain what otherwise looked like strange coincidences in the way the model of particles that we have is put together. So the fact that these didn't show up, but both of those experiments, I think, tell us something about the direction which physics might be going, in which symmetries, new symmetries, will perhaps play less of a role, new regions of the universe or new ways of putting together three-dimensional space might play more of a role.
Actually, I realize I'm the oldest person on this panel, and I entered grad school in 1974, and that was a very exciting time. The standard model was very new, the so-called standard model of particle physics, and lots of exciting ideas such as grand unification came along at that time. And that was my first love, and the first physics paper I ever read was a paper on unification that said lepton number is the fourth color, and the mathematics of grand unification interested me greatly. And I've written many papers on grand unification, and one of the sad things, this is again a negative development, is that the most important prediction of grand unification, which is that protons are unstable and decay, has not been confirmed experimentally, and that I regard as a great tragedy, because if it's never seen, then a large fraction of my papers are become irrelevant, I guess. But there's been a lot. So in that, but there have been two exciting hints in favor of grand unification, which I think they're only hints. One was the discovery of neutrino oscillations, which I think that was perhaps the biggest. Well, first I should say the main storyline of the last 40 years is that the standard model works, and it has passed every test, and most of the great discoveries in particle physics have been confirmations of the standard model, the discovery of the W boson, the Z boson, the Higgs boson, and so on. But as far as things that are new, that are not part of the standard model, there haven't been that many new and earth-shaking discoveries, but one is dark energy that Raphael just mentioned. Another is neutrino oscillations, that neutrinos, different types of neutrinos oscillate into each other, which was really sort of shown convincingly in 1998. And I think that, in some sense, gives a little bit of a hint for grand unification, because the most plausible theory of neutrino masses suggests that the scale at which that's happening, they're getting mass, is up near the grand so-called grand unification scale. So that's a little bit of a hint. But there's been a lot of progress in the area. I think there's been most progress is in all of the new quarks and leptons. Well, when I was in graduate school, they discovered the charm quark and the tau lepton and so on. Now we know that there are three families of quarks and leptons, six types of leptons, and we know 18 numbers describing their masses and mixing angles, so-called mixing angles. When I was in grad school, we knew six of those numbers. Now we know 18. So we've learned a tremendous amount, but we don't have a theory of it. So there's one area of particle physics where experiment has been finding all sorts of interesting things, but we have still no compelling theory of it. And so I regard that as one of the great places in particle physics where we have the chance to make some huge discovery in the future. Where the experiment is way out ahead of theory. Maybe I better stop there so I don't ramble on like an old codger.
So I'm going to go farther back in time to 100 years ago when mankind, womankind, whatever, knew almost nothing about the universe. People thought that every bright object out there was inside the Milky Way. Even at the time of Einstein's theoretical breakthroughs in relativity, it was that people didn't know that. And eventually they started calling them island universes, and now of course we know that there's galaxies, tons of them everywhere. And so the progress over the last century has been mind-boggling, and I have to say, since my time in graduate school, there has been breakthrough after breakthrough after breakthrough on the side of data. So I think of all of us, I may be the most astrophysical, and there's no way in hell in graduate school that we would have seen, when I was in graduate school, that we would have seen this coming. So one of the big tools, there's a lot of them, but it was the cosmic microwave background, the leftover light from the early hot days of the universe. And from that, we have answered questions from 100 years ago, namely, what is the geometry of the universe? What is the curvature of the universe? And the answer is that it's flat, at least very close to flat. And we also know the universe is 14 billion years old. We have a pie picture of the universe that contains, well, this is the very surprising thing, all the stuff that we're used to on a daily basis, our bodies and the air and the chairs and all that, made of atoms, all of that is only 5% of the total. And we're forced to figure out what is the other 95%, the 25% dark matter, and the rest, the dark energy. And so trying to figure out, so we now have these new questions of trying to figure out what makes up this pie. So to me, these are some of the very deep, important questions for the future. By the way, the dark matter problem dates back to 1930. And then I think another thing that we've learned from data is we've learned something about structure formation. What are the initial seeds that lead to the formation of galaxies and clusters and so on? And so here we have this early period in the universe called inflationary cosmology, which is an accelerating, expanding period in the universe. And it makes predictions, and a lot of these predictions have been verified, including nearly scale invariant perturbations that match data and would give us the structures we see today. So to me, this is sort of revolutionary amounts of data that have come out, but leaving us on the theory side and on the side of experiment with a lot more to do.
For me, one of the biggest discoveries in the last 20 years has been the discovery of primordial fluctuations and the characterization of primordial fluctuations. Katie described the universe is flat, but at long distances it has small curvature fluctuations. And the fact that these are Gaussian, very nearly Gaussian, and scale invariance being great, a great advance. And it happened really very quickly. In 20 years, we learned a lot about it. And I hope that in the next 20 years, we'll learn even much more about perhaps the non-Gaussian fixtures. And it's interesting to reflect about this because the leading theory for explaining these fluctuations is the theory of inflation, which postulates that they originated quantum mechanically. And so normally we think that quantum mechanics applies to small things like atoms and so on. But it turns out that quantum mechanics seems to be crucial also to explain the larger scales in the universe. So when we look at the biggest things in the universe, the largest structures, the leading theory for explaining it is that they originated through quantum fluctuations and they have this quantum mechanical origin. So quantum mechanics at long distances, far from being irrelevant, is actually extremely relevant and it's actually the leading theory we have to explain it. Also, it's often said that quantum gravity only matters at very short distances. But the computation of inflation is really quantum gravity computation. I mean, it's a scalar field coupled to gravity. And if you go through the computation, you see that gravity mixes with the scalar field in a very characteristic way. And you basically cannot do the calculation without quantizing gravity. Of course, seeing gravity waves would be a more direct confirmation of the fact that you need to quantize gravity. But I would say that even the scalar fluctuations are an indirect confirmation of that. Another point that often people say is that, well, there is Hawking radiation and we haven't yet seen Hawking radiation and, well, maybe it's not there and so on. But the mechanism that produces the fluctuations is essentially the same mechanism that produces Hawking radiation. So that's another effect that involves the quantum mechanics and the presence of horizons and so on that gives rise to these fluctuations. Okay,
thank you. Good evening to everybody. So I think it's very clear from previous speakers that although we all are theorists, when we consider what is important for cosmology, everybody was speaking about experiments or observations. So it is really these two things that are drivers for our field. And Leszek asked us to bring up one perhaps the major event in that regard during the last 20, 30 years. And I would say that it was the discovery of the fact that the cosmic microwave temperature is not the same in each direction. And this was made by, that was referred to by Juan here, that was made by a satellite called COBE. That happened in 1991 or two now, depending on how you count. And that was a transformative thing in the sense that you could say that there was cosmology before that and cosmology after, because before that there were even doubts. I've heard sort of people who I took to be sane to claim that there might be some doubts as to whether Big Bang actually was there, because we knew that there had to be these, as they are called, perturbations, the temperature fluctuations, and as long as they were not observed, there were some doubts. There were great doubts about inflation, which was predicting these fluctuations, but once they were observed, I think sort of in a sociological sense, what followed was a sort of explosion of the field. Suddenly, cosmology stopped to be a kind of a hobby of particle physicists that they do on a rainy day when they don't have anything better to do. And suddenly there started to be people who called themselves cosmologists. I don't think that before, like in the 80s, they probably were not professors of cosmology. They did not exist because it was a bit of a dubious occupation, and you had to sort of be a little bit ashamed to say that, well, I do cosmology, but I'm not really very serious about it, but you do it for a joke. But after Kobe, it no longer was a joke. And now we've seen, following that observation, we've seen this great expansion, new satellites which have measured to unprecedented accuracy the structure of the cosmic microwave background. New theories have been developed, inflation has been studied, and so on and so forth. But that, I think you must, or you should see this one single observation, this one satellite as being the trigger. Of course, there has been many other things, but certainly if you want to sort of name one milepost, I should like to name that.
Excellent. So let me just perhaps first comment quickly on, or just add to this, partly or mainly to the non-experts in the field, is that 100 years ago, particle physics looked like a basically closed field. It was called what we call now classical physics, and it looked like we needed just a few little things to fix before it would be a closed book. And then at the turn of the 20th century, quantum mechanics was discovered, which turned things upside down, and if you're interested in physics, you certainly have heard about all the revolution that it brought to the field. 100 years ago, as Katie mentioned, the universe was a very small place. It was just our galaxy. And it was also a very boring place. It was supposed to be infinite, unchanging, never having the beginning, never having the end, basically a boring place, nothing of interest. And then there came the theory of relativity of Einstein in 1915, we're celebrating the 100th anniversary of it, which one of whose implications was that there could be the beginning of the universe. There could be a big bang. And soon after, Hubble discovered that the universe was actually expanding. The universe started living. The universe became a dynamical place where many things were happening. And then things started following. Can you mention it? Dark matter was identified as one of the components in the universe in the 30s initially, then with increasing evidence in the 60s, in the 70s, it became a major component of the universe. Going back to Ambleside, I try to remember what were the main topics that were discussed there. And of course, CMB was discovered. It was discussed extensively because that was right soon after the first measurements of anisotropies in the cosmic microwave background radiation, which confirmed the idea of how galaxies formed. Another major topic that was discussed was, of course, dark matter. And I remember people like Rocky insisting that omega, the direct density of dark matter, is basically, compared to the critical density, basically one. And astronomers were saying we can only see 0.3, 30%. And he was saying, no, it should be 90%. And there was a discrepancy, huge discrepancy. And Rocky was just, and others were just insisting, look harder. Instead, astronomers, other astronomers, found another component in the universe, which we call dark energy, which we believe makes the universe expand faster and faster, accelerate. So we had a revolution right after. Of course, other things were also discussed, inflation models in various forms. But even in 18 years, the field has changed enormously. But so that we don't just confine ourselves to this discussion, first of all, let me ask you if you would like to comment on each other's sort of list of things, and then I'll ask you, the audience, to either ask questions or comment on the statements.
Very brief comment. So Kari's comment about the anisotropies in the cosmic wave background with the COBE satellite went to a Nobel Prize also to Smoot and Mather. But the one that I don't understand why it's never happened is Vera Rubin for dark matter. So she's in her 80s. Let's hurry up.
Okay, this is her groundbreaking work in the 60s where she studied spiral galaxies, and she was first to find with her team that there was plenty of that there was sort of indirect evidence for plenty of non-luminous matter inside and also mostly outside of the galaxies, right?
I have a comment. Something happened around 40 years ago, or maybe it was earlier. Maybe if there are yet older people here, they would know. But it seems to me traditionally, the kinds of things people were trying to explain were almost entirely the properties, why is the electrical conductivity of copper the what it is? Or why is the boiling point of water what it is? But since the standard model came along, the standard model, we have this beautiful theory that seems to fit explain almost everything. But a lot of the questions now have to do with not the properties of things, but trying to understand why are the parameters in the standard model, why are these coefficients, these constants of nature, why do they have the values they do? Why is the electron mass what it is? Why is the electromagnetic force have the strength that it does? And that's it seems to me that kind of question was not so prominent before. And so there's, I think, been a qualitative shift, at least in my lifetime. That we're all still asking the traditional kinds of questions. We're also asking this question of why are these constants in the equations? Why do they have the values they do? And in some sense, those are almost aesthetic questions, because from one point of view, you could say, well, they are what they are. If they fit the data, that's fine. And so we're not asking about fitting data. We're asking, where did these numbers come from, which is a different kind of question.
I think it's the same kind of question. I mean, you had the heat the conductivity of copper, or the electrical conductivity of copper. There were constants that were appearing in the equations of physics, and now we have the corresponding constants, and hopefully there will be a theory that explains them all in a simpler way.
Yeah, I agree. Though you knew copper was made up of atoms, but we don't know whether the electrons and muons and things are made up of something smaller. I mean, so as far as we know, they could be just fundamental constants. So it's kind of a guess on our part that they're not. That they're
Yeah. So I expected a lot of people to mention the CMB, and I just feel like maybe it's useful to clarify that there are really, I think, two big triumphs that came out of studying this background radiation. One is the one that you emphasized, where all of a sudden we finally did see these anisotropies, which were the seeds of what eventually became structure and galaxies and the clumpy stuff we see in the universe. And that was a sort of one hero story. It was the satellite, COBE, and they did this. But then everything else pretty much that came out of the cosmic microwave background came from studying fluctuations on quite small scales that COBE couldn't even see. And there's a huge wealth of information in that. And one should also mention that people study the distribution of matter in the universe. That's another wonderful way to learn about the history of the universe, how it expanded. And that was many experiments, some bigger, some smaller. But it took us from a situation where we did not know how fast the universe even expanded better than to a factor of two, to a situation where, you know, we have six parameters, many of which have been measured to many digits, that turn out to completely describe the way that we see how the universe behaved and is behaving now. We can see the clumping history of the universe, the expansion history of the universe, with unbelievable precision. It's as if you had gone from, I don't know, some primitive screen that had 9x9 pixels to some nice high resolution Panasonic, you know, video screen. That's how clearly we can see the universe compared to 20 years ago.
Well, also its usefulness for particle physics. I mean, we know that we are close to perhaps determining the neutrino masses from this type of experiments.
Yeah, we call it the standard model of cosmology now. A lot of unexplained pieces, but the detailed measurement of these parameters is stunning.
If I may comment still, but perhaps the striking thing that all this progress in cosmology has been mainly driven by observations, and in fact quite little, to my mind, quite little of it is due to advances in theory. I mean, we have basically the theory or model or whatever you want to call it of inflation, but it's the same thing with sort of adiabatic modifications, small modifications, that was there already at the beginning of the 80s. I mean, we have more complicated, we have zillions of models of different type, but basically what it boils down to is that this is more or less the same thing. So not much progress in the way of really deeply understanding anything. And as is usual in these kind of things, you may this see as a challenge. Yeah.
So I have a quick comment on that, which is that one, I think, the cosmic microwave background, in this case the Planck satellite, had a major contribution. It ruled out most inflationary models with the lack of non-Gaussianities.
Instead of 10,000, there are no longer only 1,000.
No, so. I don't think there's too many good ones left.
I guess that nearly every panel member is holding or getting a microphone into their hand. At this point, I think it's a good time to actually ask you on the other side if you have any comments or questions on what has been said so far. Mats was the first, being the senior members of the family, of the audience. You were still the first, so go ahead. Mats Ruiz from Helsinki.
I just wanted to add a little brick to the building of the standard model, which I think is of historical interest. In 1960, I was a research assistant to Oscar Klein in Stockholm, and at that time, 4K mesons were known and 3π mesons were known, and Klein was struggling to find a symmetry, a model where he could build. He tried SU3, but he gave it up because there was no eta where he expected it to be.
For a long time in theoretical physics, we know that it's derived for due to naturalness, like for naturalness. But now, since LHC has found not anything else apart from Higgs, and I mean, how we should look from this perspective? Should we give up our the naturalness arguments, or accept this thing that there is tuning and something like that?
I think this will probably come during the discussion at a slightly later stage, unless somebody wants to jump into this right away.
I'd agree with what Kari said about the picture of cosmology that has sort of been confirmed. There's only one really shocking and surprising element. I mean, people were talking about dark matter, people were talking about inflation a long time ago, but the dark energy, I think, came as a tremendous shock and compounded a mystery that was already there. People in the past couldn't understand why there was no cosmological constant. But it appeared to everyone to be zero because it was zero to 120 decimal places. And everyone kind of assumed, well, if it's zero to 120 decimal places, it's obviously going to be exactly zero. And that probably is due to some deep principle that says it must be exactly zero. We don't know what that principle is, but we'll eventually find it. And so it was a mystery, but, you know, zero is a nice round number. And so I don't think people were too upset. But then when you find out it's not zero, but actually is 10 to the minus 120, suddenly that mystery was much, much stranger. And so I think that of all, in the last 40 years, I think that was the only shocking discovery in particle physics or cosmology.
Can I comment on that? Yeah. I completely agree with what you said. It was a shocking discovery and it changed the thinking of an enormous part of the community and rattled this assumption that the cosmological constant should just be zero. However, that assumption never made any sense, right? For example, if you assume that it's zero now, you can calculate that it was not zero in the early universe. So there can't possibly be such a principle. But that, you know, it was a sociological, oftentimes that's how science works. There's a big shift and suddenly, you know, a boulder starts rolling. But to come back to your question, you used the term naturalness, I used the term new symmetries. It's always been tricky for hundreds of years. It's been tricky for scientists to sort out the things that are environmental accidents from the things that they should actually try to explain by some nice elegant theory. Right? Kepler thought that he should explain the ratios of the sizes of the planetary orbits in terms of some nice elegant theory, which for him were some platonic solids, which with a lot of tweaking and cheating more or less fit the data. And of course, that was a hopeless task. But he was certainly a person who was capable of coming up with very nice and elegant theories. So you can see that the best of us, much better than anybody, make mistakes. And so we'll continue making mistakes. I think, you know, what we should do is explore both possibilities for a while.
I have one comment about the cosmological constant. So it's often said that maybe it was zero and being non-zero is a mystery. For me, it's an equal mystery that it's zero or non-zero. Because if you imagine there was a symmetry that made sure it's zero, you could imagine the symmetry being violated by some very small instanton effects or something that could be very small. I mean, nature generated big hierarchies, like the hierarchy between the Planck scale and the mass of the proton. So in a similar way, it could generate a big hierarchy with cosmological constant. I mean, the problem is we don't have such a symmetry, so. Simply don't view the fact that it's non-zero as more mysterious than it is zero.
Just on naturalness, it seems that there's something. There may be something wrong with the idea of naturalness. We have not seen the three naturalness problems that most people talk about are the cosmological constant problem, the gauge hierarchy problem, and the strong CP problem. But we haven't seen axions. We still haven't, which was supposed to be the best explanation of the strong CP problem. We haven't seen low energy supersymmetry, which was supposed to be the best explanation of the gauge hierarchy problem. So there may be just something very wrong with the whole idea of naturalness, but.
Actually I would like to jump in here with a little personal note here, which is since I work on the low energy supersymmetry, at the last meeting in Morion, I was sort of confronted with questions about why do you still think that low energy supersymmetry is the right path, since there's been no evidence found whatsoever. The lower limits on superpartner masses have been sort of raised to the level of about 1,000 GeV, it's just unnatural. And at that point, I sort of got annoyed and I formulated a statement that natural is what is realized by nature. And people just laughed at me. They thought this was this crazy thing because we have those principles of naturalness that we think we understand. Then I went to a beautiful meeting that Katie organized in Stockholm at the beginning of June, Cosmic Odyssey, where I talked with Frank Wilczek, Nobel Prize winner. And Frank said something, you know, we talk about naturalness, and he said, you know, I really get annoyed with this whole discussion about naturalness. Natural is what is basically realized in nature. I said, Frank, I love it. This is exactly what I said. You know, earlier on, I thought the same thing. I think we are just too much hooked up on various preconceptions that we have. And naturalness might be one of them. It might be an interesting guiding principle, but should not treat it as a sacred principle. Nature has surprised us already several times, and using naturalness as a guiding principle can be very dangerous. Dangerous.
Yeah, if I just may add one more. I mean, indeed, the example of Kepler is excellent because he thought that he would have to do everything with circular orbits because they were more symmetric. So symmetry or simplicity may not be the things that nature chooses. Another example is the theory of gravity. In 1913, there was a competing theory of gravity, the Nordström theory, that was a scalar gravity theory with only one scalar field. And now if at that point there would have been a panel discussing this simple theory with only one scalar field and the theory of this Herr Einstein, who had 12 fields, what would we have said? I mean, this is too complicated.
Unnatural.
Unnatural.
Okay, there was this question from Kostas.
I just wanted to support the opposite corner now. Okay. I want to remind, everybody knows, of course, that when cosmology was first attempted by Einstein and others, they assumed for simplicity that the universe is homogeneous and isotropic. They assumed for simplicity that the universe was homogeneous and isotropic because it made the problem simpler and because it was elegant and symmetric. Now, of course, we know that observation confirms this, the cosmological principle, which is no longer a principle, it's an observation. So, I'm trying to say that symmetry and elegance may be misleading sometimes, but may also show the way some other times.
Can I just make a comment? If gravity had been a scalar field, we would now be worried about the unnaturalness of it having a zero mass, whereas at least with Einstein's theory, we feel that we have a symmetry principle that tells us that. So I think that's kind of...
Well, that's
fact. So, I mean, you know this, that technically natural has a meaning. It means that it's some small parameter is okay if, when you take it to zero, you restore a symmetry. And so, okay, so I mean, I don't want to self-advertise, but in inflation, you need to have a potential that goes on and on and on to get enough inflation, but then you need to have the height low to get the density perturbations right. And so in natural inflation, it's technically natural. You keep this small parameter small because of the underlying shift symmetry. So I don't know, I like that.
Well, I mean, you could also say that inflation was solving a certain naturalness problem because you had the flatness of space-time, and just having it incredibly flat near the time of the Big Bang is unnatural. But now we have a dynamical mechanism of inflation that flattens space-time. So there's a case where, in some sense, the idea that we don't like small numbers to be small for no reason has actually led to a breakthrough, right? I mean, it turned out to be there was a mechanism for it.
Yeah, but I think we've all agreed that in physics physicists have been trying for generations to find a deeper, more fundamental explanation for phenomena, for things, for numbers. And in some cases, it's worked beautifully. The formulation of the standard model is a beautiful confirmation of that. One could unify electromagnetic and weak forces, and then those forces with strong forces in a consistent field theory model. But there are other areas where it doesn't seem to be that we are quite as successful. One thing that has been suddenly mentioned is the cosmological constant problem. Various attempts have been made to explain it in a fundamental way, and yet the explanation, if I can say, call it this way, that is often quoted has been provided by Steven Weinberg back in the late 80s, is the explanation based on some sort of anthropic considerations. He basically said that a non-zero cosmological, small non-zero cosmological constant in our universe is what it is because it allows us observers to actually think about it, to be there and hear and observe it and think about it. So this broadens or changes the perspective. Perhaps there are some things which we can understand in fundamental terms, and there are some things which are environmental. Dark matter, the amount of dark matter. I've been working on this myself, and there's no compelling theory linking, with all due respect to everybody who has been working on it, including myself, there's no compelling mechanism that links the amount of dark matter in the universe with the amount of ordinary baryonic matter in the universe. So is the ratio 5:1 a fundamental thing that we should try to explain in a fundamental theory, or is it just an accident, a property of our universe, somewhat accidental, environmental? These are the questions. You want to comment on that?
Sure. So, I've worked on both of these problems, one more recently than the other. I guess what I would want to say first is there's no such thing as the multiverse. So it's often said, you know, the multiverse is this and the multiverse is that, and it's not science. And there's such thing as theories or models that are fleshed out to various degrees of completion. And from these theories, you can try to derive what they tell you. And they either lead to a multiverse, by which I would mean that there's a theory in which there's more than one way of making three-dimensional stable space. Perhaps these different ways of making it have different particles and different forces in them. And there are other theories which just predict one way of doing this. And which of these theories is right is a scientific question. It's not something that we can simply declare to start with. One class of these theories just can't be right because there's no inconsistency in them. It's just that they give a richer phenomenology. The best way of thinking about them, I think, is not the way it's usually done by saying they produce this enormously large multiverse where they're far away, these distant regions that we'll never see. A much better way of thinking about it is to say they enrich the number of possibilities of what could have happened in our universe. Right? You can't make an argument that, well, you know, the planetary orbits are just accidental unless you have a variety in your theory. In cosmology, in standard cosmology, we have many solar systems and the planets form in a sort of random way, and of course you get a variety that way. And in these theories, there are other things that vary as well. If they don't vary from the start, then you can't make an anthropic argument to constrain them.
Can I ask you to maybe to explain that?
You can explain to the non-experts what the idea of the multiverse is to start with.
Oh, okay. Good. Right. So we don't, even in our universe, you've perhaps noticed that we don't live in a very typical space. Most of the universe is empty, and there's just a little bit of radiation. And we live in a place which has an unusually high matter density, and we're not very surprised that this is the case. Because, well, we're made out of matter, and so it's a good chance you live where the matter is. But the nice thing is that we can also see these other regions. So this is something that we can, they're not hidden away from us. Now, unfortunately, there are things that we cannot see. So what we see of the universe today are the things that have had time in 13.7 billion years to travel to our eyes or our telescopes. And tomorrow we'll see a little bit more. There are literally things outside the universe today We haven't seen them yet. Nevertheless, we talk about them all the time because our theories make use of much bigger regions. Now, there are theories in which these regions, once you go far enough away, the regions that we haven't seen yet, might look very different from the region that we do see. They don't all have to look the same. It's true that probably for quite a long distance, they'll look more or less the same, but then there might be a transition, like you're leaving a pool of water and you're entering air, and a lot of things are different. The speed of sound is different. Things change. You have theories that predict that. You might have another theory that doesn't. If you have a theory that does, the only way you can test that theory is to figure out what it predicts for the universe that we do see, what is likely and what is not likely. So those are called multiverse theories. They are theories in which the universe gets very, very large, and there are different widely separated regions in which you have different effective physics, even though fundamentally it's the same thing, just the way that water and air are all made out of the same elementary particles. But you know, if you don't probe at very short distance scales, they do look like totally different things. So the question that I think we're facing is whether the universe actually works that way. And some evidence pointing in that direction comes from the cosmological constant, the fact that we don't know how to explain why it's so small, why there's so little acceleration, other than by the idea that, in fact, it can take on many different values, and the universe is full of all these different places where there's lots of different amounts of acceleration, and we live in the places where that acceleration is small enough to not cause really bad things to happen, like galaxies to get disrupted, for example, and not ever form in the first place.
So I have a comment. So in some sense, we already have a multiverse with the theory we have with the fluctuations. So we have that the particular pattern of fluctuations we have in our universe, well, is unique to this universe, and we predict it from a statistical theory that where there could be other possibilities. And in fact, in other regions of the universe, it's different. And we are not bothered by this. We use this all the time. But quantum mechanics being a probabilistic theory, we would expect to predict probabilities for how the universe should look like, and certainly for the fluctuations we do. But we seem to not have a good theory for predicting things that are constant in our universe. So things like the values of the coupling constants, the laws of nature, for example, even something as simple as the curvature, overall curvature of the universe. So where it's flat, or it's positively curved, or negatively curved. There is no good theory that predicts what this value is. Of course, inflation predicts if you assume with the assumption that it lasted for more than 60 folds, it assumes that it predicts that it's flat. But you could have some other ideas. So for example, some ideas about the multiverse predict that we should see it negatively curved at some point. If you thought about the Hadley-Hawking wave function of the universe, you would predict it's so positively curved that we wouldn't be living, I mean, we know we are not living in the universe predicted by this Hadley-Hawking wave function. So we don't have any good theory for predicting this. And it's worse for all the other parameters. And I think personally, so the problem of the multiverse is that our theories are too primitive to handle it properly and to get concrete probabilities out of this picture. And so it's mostly since I'm a theorist, I view it as a challenge for theorists to figure out how to get some concrete predictions out of the multiverse.
Yeah, I would add maybe one thing, which is that there's often this worry that you can't rule out these theories because, you know, we can't go look at all these distant regions. They're too far away. Light from them has not reached us. And in fact, according to the theory, you can wait as long as you want. It'll never reach us. And I think the important thing to understand is that all theories that we know and love and think are true to very good accuracy have the property that they predict a lot of things that we can't check. You cannot, from first principles, you know, figure out how complicated nuclei are put together. Maybe we're getting there, but it certainly looks pretty hopeless. But that's not why, you know, we don't go and say we don't believe in the theories we have of the nucleus, because we can test it in other ways, which are very characteristic. You have to just find some diagnostic where you can really test something that's very specific about the theory. It's really hard, and that's the real problem in the case of the multiverse, because we don't understand the underlying theory nearly well enough. But as a
you know, as a statement of just, well, this is because it predicts these other things that we can't check, it's not science, I think that's wrong. What we need to do is understand the theory well enough so that we can test it against some prediction. And in fact, multiverse theories have already been ruled out. There were concrete theories that were proposed after Weinberg's idea, which were soon realized by their own authors to lead to an empty universe with such enormous probability that what we see in those theories has essentially probability zero. And that is the usual scientific criterion for ruling out a theory. So those theories were dead. In fact, my work on this subject came from trying to fix that problem.
Can I ask you a question? Sure. So, I mean, something that I've worked on in the past were supersymmetric grand unified theories. And in a typical supersymmetric grand unified theory, there are several solutions. There are several degenerate ground states, at least if so in supersymmetric SU5, there are ground states where you break down to the standard model, but there are others where you break down to SU4 across U1, others where you break down to different. And so presumably, if we had found, if they might turn out to be true, but if we, suppose we knew that a supersymmetric grand unified theory was correct, we would practically be forced to believe in a multiverse of a certain sort, because this regions of the universe that are too so far away from us that they were not causally in causal contact presumably fell into a different ground state, and you'd have, you know, things would look very different there. My question is this. I mean, there's an example of a kind of a not very rich multiverse, because you might have only three or four different possibilities. What are some of the theories? Do we know that superstring theory does lead to a multiverse? And what are some of these theories you were mentioning that, that people have proposed that give you a multiverse structure?
So the ones that I was referring to for the experts in the audience are the theories of Abbott and Brown and Teitelbaum. Uh-huh. And they were only trying to solve the cosmological constant problem. They were trying to find a way. The cosmological constant is the energy of empty space. It sounds crazy if you're not a physicist, but empty space not only can have an energy, but this wonderful standard model of particle physics that we were just gushing about predicts that it should have an absolutely enormous energy. And this energy of empty space is what's causing acceleration of the universe. And if it had an enormous energy, it would cause much more acceleration than we see. Right, so explaining why there's so little, that's the cosmological constant problem. Now, these guys tried to do that by simply aligning lots of ways of making the same kind of three-dimensional space, only different in how much energy empty space had. You could get stuck. It's like they called it a washboard potential. It's like you get stuck in a little bump or trough in the washboard, and because of quantum mechanics, after a long time, even though you're stuck there, you can magically tunnel down to the next one down, and you keep tunneling down until you've basically annihilated or decreased the energy of empty space to a point where you're in a universe like ours. And the problem with that theory was that, well, that works. You can get rid of the cosmological constant, but you're also getting rid of all other matter. And this is a property that all theories of this type have, because gravity doesn't even know what the value of the cosmological constant is unless you clear out the view for it, and the other matter clouds the view. And so it's impossible to dynamically select for the cosmological constant that we see. And so these models were indeed ruled out, but they do lead to a multiverse. And so that's a wonderful example of a multiverse theory that has been ruled out.
But that's a sort of a model. But what about superstring theory?
If I may inject something here, the thing is that a multiverse might exist or might not. But the thing is that logically, from the fact that you have a thing like a cosmological constant that they cannot predict or explain, does not follow anything. I mean, it does not entail anything. It just means that we can't do it. And if there might be a zillion of reasons why we can't do it. And you might say to you, it sounds plausible that we might explain it in such and such way. But let's take a long view. In the medieval times, there were people who were claiming that the motions of the planets cannot be explained because, I mean, they are divine. I mean, they are beyond human understanding. And you know, it took a few hundred years to revert this position, and maybe if we just wait for a couple of hundred years, we might again have a different view on cosmological constant.
Can I clear up a misunderstanding for just a second? So there are actually two. One is, I was referring only to a specific class of approaches to the cosmological constant problem, which I argue cannot work. I was not saying that there cannot possibly be an alternative to a landscape or multiverse approach. That those are two very different statements, obviously. We do get occasionally to a point where we understand that a certain idea will just not work out because of a certain specific reason. And that's all I was saying. That doesn't mean there couldn't be other ideas. So far, I don't think there are any, but certainly there could, and I would encourage us to look for them. The other is that you seem to be implying that a landscape explanation is not an explanation. That I would certainly object to. It's not necessarily the right
one. Well, that now depends on what you call an explanation. What is an explanation? And that is a sort of a deep philosophical...
Which we'll get to
we don't in a really second. Want to get, we don't to get really to want to get into that.
We do, actually. I think we should talk about it. Okay, you want to say something? Because
I'm with Kari. I think that just because we haven't found a solution yet within our simple universe doesn't mean we're not going to. And that's true. I see that for all of these problems. So the question is, are we actually forced to a multiverse, not just because we haven't solved some problem, but for other reasons? And so, for example, are we forced to it by eternal inflation? Are we forced to it by string theory? And that's an entirely different question.
Can I say something?
Very quickly, because I want to...
I think one should let a thousand flowers bloom, or whatever the saying is. Some particles are very light because of a symmetry, so the photon. The proton is very light compared to the Planck scale for a different kind of reason, because the logarithmically running gauge coupling, and we sort of understand that very small number, but in a completely different way. So there could be yet another way that something might be very small, which could be a landscape or a multiverse explanation. Just because I don't think anyone is saying, people who take the landscape or the multiverse seriously are saying, is that's one possible explanation. It doesn't mean that we're saying these other explanations couldn't be right. Some people might try to explain the smallness of the weak scale, or the weak and track scale, by technicolor, which is one kind of explanation, a dynamical explanation. Other people try to use supersymmetry, which is a symmetry explanation. But it could also be an anthropic or multiverse explanation. And a priori, we don't know which one it is, and I don't think we should rule any of those out as possibilities.
But just a quick warning here. The first proponent of a multiverse was probably Giordano Bruno, who said that there is an infinity of worlds, and he was burnt on stake on Campo di Fiori in Rome.
So as a historical point, historians actually say
that
was one of a whole laundry list of things for which he was burned, and probably not one of the more important ones. So it was not. That's a little bit of an oversimplification.
Well, yes, but that was...
You're proposing that we be burned at the stake?
No, I'm just...
He was burned.
It was a Thursday, like incidentally today.
He was burned for religious heresies, not for scientific ones. But let me turn to the audience. I mean, first of all, critics of the multiverse scenario say that it doesn't matter if it is right or wrong, because it's simply not science. That's what we sometimes hear from the people. Let me ask you what you think by just raising your hand. Be brave. Do you think multiverse hypothesis, considering it, is science or not? You may want to close your eyes, Raphael. Is this science or is it not?
How many in favor, how many against?
Yes, who thinks about... Who thinks multiverse hypothesis is science? Who thinks it's not science? Well, it's still quite a number of people.
How many don't know?
How many people don't know?
That's very reasonable.
So I think the numbers are quite comparable, in fact, some people think it is science, people think it's not science. People don't know. Let me just jump in here with a historical remark and also to sort of set the stage for perhaps further discussion. 100 years ago or so, more or less.
Was there a question?
Was there? Oh, hey, feel free.
I just wanted to ask the same question to the panel, actually, in light of the multiverse discussion, if they wanted to answer the question of the evening. So is modern physics crossing the boundaries of science?
Can you repeat the question?
So practically the same question you just asked the audience. I just wanted to ask the panel if they wanted to address the question of the evening in light of the previous discussion.
So is the multiverse hypothesis science or not? Eh?
Yeah, is modern physics crossing the boundaries of science?
How do we answer the question, which was the main question of this panel?
Feel free to take turns.
I think there are questions which are meaningful questions that are scientific questions but may turn out not to be answerable by the methods of empirical science. I'd say they might be scientific. So, for example, we may never be able to tell if the universe is infinitely large or finite, you know, it's closed or open. We might never be able to determine whether it's infinite into the past or has a temporal beginning. There are a lot of, and those are meaningful questions, and I think they're scientific questions. We may be unlucky, and maybe we won't be able to answer them, in which case I would say they're scientific questions that have somehow ended up not being resolvable by empirical methods, and so they're maybe not empirical science.
But physics is supposed to be an empirical science, right? Testable science. If physics makes predictions that cannot be tested, is this still science?
Well, I think that we should hold them, you know, all theories to the same standard. So I don't think we should give the multiverse some kind of lower criteria for, you know, for what constitutes a valid scientific theory. That's why I'm saying it's going to be hard, because it means understanding the theory well, understanding statistically what it predicts will be likely and not likely observed in a region, and then testing that against observation. But as a matter of principle, it clearly can be done. The problem is that we're not very good at it yet.
Well, you gave examples for how...
I think we should not confuse the fact that the multiverse could exist with the fact that we are confused about how to get predictions out of the multiverse. So these are two different things. I mean, I think the theory is not developed enough to deal with this and to get concrete predictions out of it. And hopefully theorists will find how to do it. But that doesn't say whether a multiverse exists or not. You can ask the question of whether working on a theory before it was confirmed is scientific or not. I believe it is part of science to work on a theory before it is actually experimentally confirmed. But of course, physics, the theories that are accepted in physics are the ones that have been experimentally confirmed. Then you are part of physics. Otherwise, you are searching for new physics, searching for new theories.
I think all of us are going to agree that for a theory to survive, it must eventually make experimental predictions and it must be tested. Otherwise, it's not science.
But perhaps there is a larger context in the sense that before science was called science, it was natural philosophy, and that was science. Was scientist was a term that was appeared only in the 19th century. So in some sense, you could say that some of these considerations that might eventually be sort of outside of any empirical verification or even some sort of confirmation, they might in some sense be joining this tradition. Understanding the world in a sort of a larger sense than in terms of immediately measurable things. Whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, I don't know, but that's we are here to discuss that, I suppose.
But
a lot depends on how lucky you are. I mean, we've been very lucky. What if the electromagnetism had not been... it's a very weak force, so you can actually calculate things pretty accurately. What if it had been a very strong force in which you couldn't? I mean, we might not have discovered a lot of things that we have been able to discover.
But then we would not exist.
That's true. But so now, take grand unified theories. I mean, it could very well be, it's probably more likely than not, that we will never see proton decay or neutron, anti-neutron oscillations or other things predicted by it. And that would be, in my view, a tragedy. And then we would, it would just be a theory that could never be tested in practice. But it's science, and there's a lot of indirect circumstantial evidence that there's some truth to it. But who says we have to continue being lucky about being able to verify this?
Steve Keen.
I just want to say that sometimes we have to wait a long time for things to be tested. Sorry, I'm a bit dry. The neutrino was proposed in 1930, and the people that proposed it thought that it could not be tested. It wasn't until 1956 when actually it was discovered. So we have to wait a long time. And subsequently, it wasn't until 1998 that it was discovered to have a mass. So this is a long period of time. And sometimes ideas that are proposed, which apparently can't be tested, eventually will be tested. I think sometimes we just have to have a lot of patience. And since I mentioned the word neutrino, I also want to make the point that I regard neutrino mass as the first evidence for physics beyond the Standard Model. And the reason for that is because, well, you just have to realize we don't know what the origin of neutrino mass is. So it clearly is physics beyond the Standard Model already. We just don't know what it is.
Another example of something that took a long time to verify is the heliocentric theory. I mean, so what actually made scientists, the majority of scientists believe that the heliocentrism was right, was actually the coming of Newtonian mechanics. Before, the first observational evidence was not until 1728 when you had the aberration of light. That's 100 years after Galileo. But it wasn't some observational test. It was the fact that you had a theory that suddenly made sense. So some of these issues were resolved first, in a sense, theoretically, and the experimental test came much, much later. In fact, some of the observations were in the 1800s, like the Foucault pendulum or the observation of stellar parallax and all that kind of thing.
Just to comment on your comment, Steve, what if we have to wait an infinite amount of time to get the theory confirmed? is this then still a theory?
Well, obviously we don't know any more than the people that proposed the neutrino. They didn't know when or if it could be tested, so we don't know.
I mean, consider cosmological theories which predict the future, right? Different models predict different future, either a continuous expansion, accelerating expansion into a very empty and cold universe, or a universe with a big crunch. You would need an observer eventually to say one or the other outcome in, you know, billions, tens of billions, or hundreds of billions of years, except that it's very unlikely that observers will survive that long. For one thing, all the stars will burn out of fuel, and there will be simply no way of supporting life, apart from all the other technical problems. So can we consider theories which predict the distant future? Scientific theories.
Yeah.
Can I comment on that? I mean, I think that fits exactly into what I said about how we don't test every prediction of a theory. So your theory could be tested by measuring the matter content of the universe very accurately and trying to figure out whether it's closed and whether it has cosmological constants, positive or negative, and so on. And obviously some things that follow from that are never going to be in our reach.
But still, in principle, there could be machines waiting for us for the big crunch. I mean, in principle, it is possible. And I do agree that we need some patience, that it took very long time for the neutrino to be actually seen. But on the other hand, at the same time, it's been extremely fast this century. So 25 years before the observation of neutrino, then in the 80s, the solar neutrinos, they were seen sort of at the rate of one per in a blue moon, and now they are discussed at being damned background. And I think that shows the fastness of this evolution, actually.
I want to say something nice about the Catholic Church since we're being filmed. So in fact, they had a scientific argument against Galileo. They get very bad press about Galileo. But they had a scientific argument. They also had others. And the scientific argument was that precisely what you alluded to, that if the Earth moved around the sun, you would have this effect that I have if I move this way and that way. You know, the guys in the front row seem to be moving in front of the guys of the back rows, right? There's this thing called parallax. The relative position of the distant stars should change a little bit depending on where the Earth is as it's going around the sun. And it simply seemed inconceivable that the distant stars were so ridiculously far away that that wouldn't be obvious if the Earth went around the sun. And so it's I think, a wonderful example in a sequence of examples. We also talked about how everything was just one galaxy. So they didn't even imagine that the nearest stars to us could be so far away that you don't see. So we've always underestimated the size of the universe at our own peril.
By the way, there was another argument that was even more stronger than that. That was based on an astronomer, a Jesuit named Riccioli, pointed out that stars seem to have a finite size when you looked at them through telescopes. Now, it was later understood that that was because of the way the lenses that were made in those days worked, that they made them look like they had a finite size. But if the stars were as big as they look through telescopes, you could infer, and given this parallax argument, that the stars would have to be ridiculously large, unbelievably large. And so there were actually pieces of evidence. It's like that with many theories. There were pieces of evidence that counted against the theory, and it was only later that one realized that they were misleading. So
perhaps in this context, I would like to quote Copernicus, who was a Catholic priest, not only an astronomer, and he allegedly said, I tried to find this in his books but couldn't. He said, the universe may be much larger than we think. That was not the revolutionary part. What was revolutionary is what he said afterwards. He said, it might be even infinite. At his times, he said, it might be even infinite.
There was somebody earlier who said that. There was a cardinal in the 1400s named Nicholas of Cusa. And he believed the universe had to be infinite. He actually not only said the universe should be infinite because to reflect God's infinity, but that there was no center and that everything was in motion, including the Earth, the sun, and everything else.
Okay.
That's actually, I learned about that in Misner, Thorne, and Wheeler. Okay. So they have a whole page about them.
Now, there is a question in the back, but I would like to carry on along sort of those lines. Is this on this subject or is this something different? You want to raise something different? There was a question in the back.
Yes, I think it's in line.
On the same line, so please go ahead.
So, do you think there are some more fundamental boundaries of physics than just experimental? Imagine that we can do any experiment we want, and including experiment in other universes and multiverse. So is then science, physics able to form some ultimate theory of universe? Do we have any limitations, for instance, from Gödel theorems or not? Is it limitation for physics?
Do we have any limitations for?
From Gödel's theorem.
You're asking if we could do any experiment with no funding limitations or practical limitations?
Yes, any limitations.
So, you know, there are limitations we can't overcome. We can't do experiments that violate the laws of physics. And that's actually important. If you could do those experiments, everything would become totally inconsistent. So we can't, you know, check directly what's happening, you know, further than away than light could have traveled us. But if you give me that kind of freedom, I could check the string multiverse by simply probing how the extra dimensions are put together, and if I can wiggle that, and there will be very direct ways of probing the degrees of freedom that are used to construct this multiverse. That's why it's important to have a theory. You can't just say the word multiverse. You would just go and look. Unfortunately,
the energies we need for that are the type that fit into your category and not into the real world. But it doesn't violate the laws of physics to do this.
My question was, is there any limitation except experimental limitation, right? Because in fact, what we can't observe other universes is experimental, I mean, physical limitation, right? But imagine that we don't have such constraints. So we can have every data we want. Can we form ultimate theory?
There is actually an interesting idea that perhaps complexity plays a role, and that you cannot realize through physical means, you cannot solve through physical means problems that are, let's say, NP-complete, or these problems computers cannot solve. And so there is also this idea that maybe this is also a principle of physics. Scott Aronson was proposing this, for example. This would be an interesting... What? Scott Aronson. And so that's an interesting idea, that these ideas of complexity might be part of physics, in the same way that, in some sense, in thermodynamics, we use some of these ideas, the idea that the second law of thermodynamics is a statistical law, and so we use some of these concepts, but maybe we need to use more.
And on top of that, of course, I mean, we are sort of finite beings, and therefore there must be some cognitive limitations to our understanding, even when sort of coupled in a parallel way, like we are at the moment. But so it could be that there are just things that we simply cannot get, no matter how hard we try.
But is this an excuse?
Oh, yeah. I want to echo something that Raphael said earlier, which is you can't test every entity that's posited to exist by a theory. Just take Maxwell's theory of electromagnetism. It posits the existence of an electric and magnetic field at every point in the universe. There's no possible way you could go out and check that there's an electric and magnetic field at every point in the universe. But you don't test theories by checking on everything that they predict. If you find a sufficient number of things that they predict, that they account for in a simple way, it gives you confidence the theory is true, and then you believe the other things that you can't check
directly. Okay, fair enough. On the other hand, Raphael used an argument for the opinion that multiverse is science, considering multiverse is science, because he said that certain models of multiverse could be ruled out. Is this enough? The question is, can they be confirmed rather than ruled out? Obviously, you know, crazy universes can be ruled out, but can we confirm the hypothesis by experiment? And that's much harder. In the old days, old good days, 100 years ago or 50 years ago, basically, a theory could be measured by all the predictions of the theory. Measurable predictions could be measured and confirmed or not confirmed, contradicted, and therefore the theory or hypothesis would be ruled out. As things got harder, and we all agree that things are getting harder, it became harder to confirm things. Even the standard model, it took so long to confirm. With the Higgs boson discovery, the discovery of the Higgs boson in 2012, some people would say, now the standard model has been confirmed. But do we agree with this? Has the standard model been confirmed? I certainly don't. Because there are other theories.
With some probability, of course. We cannot confirm anything except with some probability.
Okay, there are other theories which are close to my heart, which are theories of low energy supersymmetry, which make the same prediction of this Higgs boson, which should be, which have properties like the standard model of Higgs boson, and the mass should be up to 130 GeV. The Higgs boson that was discovered has mass 125 GeV within just that window. So I would say that perhaps this way supersymmetric theories have been to that extent confirmed as much as the standard model. We're talking now about not full evidence, but getting hints or getting partial evidence, partial confirmation for our theories. And we are heading to the situation where maybe having less and less so. You, Steve, at the beginning of your presentation, you said that your cherished loved God theories were, may never be confirmed. I was actually quite surprised that you didn't mention the fact of gauge coupling and unification. Which I think was one of the strongest things. To me, the question is gauge coupling and unification, gauge couplings were measured at LEP at the beginning of the 90s, their values, and then extrapolated using randomization group equations up to some high scale within the context of supersymmetry, they beautifully unify. Is this an experimental fact?
Well, here's, for example, suppose not. We don't see proton decay, which is, but then there are other ways you might, in a sense, confirm band unified theories. Suppose we
can I interrupt? I just ask you, when you say we'll never see proton decay,
we never see it.
No, but I mean, in the ideal experimental world, someday you will.
Well, what happens if the gut scale is up near 10 to the 19 GeV?
So this is just a question.
Are you going to build a detector? You
okay.
Know, yeah.
Okay, so, I just want to make sure I understand.
Because a proton lifetime could be orders of magnitude bigger than the biggest detector could see. But suppose we actually saw, you know, gluinos and the gaugenos, and you ran their extrapolated their masses up to very high scale, and they unified. That would be another piece, right? If you saw the gaugenos and extrapolated their masses, they might unify. I think if you have those unifying also, that's really strong evidence for grand unification. But again, the question is, how direct does the evidence have to be before you... Traditionally, it seems in particle physics, if somebody predicts a particle, people don't regard that as truly confirmed unless you produce it in an accelerator. That's kind of just sort of a matter of social convention.
Yeah.
I mean, we all kind of knew the Higgs was there, and there was all sorts of precision electroweak tests and all sorts of things that pointed to it. But by tradition, until you produced it in an accelerator, you said it wasn't confirmed. I think that's a little bit arbitrary in some of these historical standards.
Well, here's another one, inflation. How are we going to decide it's proven? Are we going to have to find the inflaton? Not in our lifetimes.
Yeah, so, I mean, Mats has a question, but let me ask the audience. Who thinks the standard model has been confirmed experimentally? Quite a few people. Who thinks it leaves, the discovery of the Higgs boson still leaves room for other theories which could, which make the same prediction? Other?
Well, I think the question is tricky because, the standard model is valid to some energies, and it could be that at higher energies there is some other theory. So all these supersymmetric theories reduce to the standard model at the energies that have been tested.
You mean confirmed as the ultimate theory. You mean confirmed as correct effective theory.
Okay, good enough. Yeah, I tried to trick you. Mats had a question or comment.
Well, I thought I had a better example than the Higgs boson to discuss whether something has been confirmed. Juan can probably confirm to me. Quantum entanglement.
Well, that's been confirmed. That's been confirmed. That's been confirmed. Yeah.
Sure. The way of observing in the simplest case, this two slit experiment, but I mean, take Bell's tests and Bell's theorems. I think that quantum entanglement is something that has been confirmed.
We're drowning in a glass of water a little bit, right? I mean, young people will always work on what looks promising and interesting, and experimentalists will always come up with new ideas of how to measure stuff. And nobody could have imagined, I mean, there are all these examples that were mentioned about, you know, Einstein thought gravitational waves would never be measured. By now, it's only a question of when, not if. Neutrinos. There were so many, you know, the motion of the Earth around the Sun. Because we can't remotely imagine what technologies will be available 50 years from now, right? We have no idea. I mean, so we think we can't ever see proton decay. Well, maybe we'll see something else through some completely different technology that is logically equivalent. You know, I think we mustn't get all frozen up about this. I mean, we should work on what looks interesting, what looks like nature might actually be that way.
Right.
Yes, I have many comments, but regarding the very last part, I agree with you that sometimes theory is lagging behind and sometimes it's ahead. and we have seen that in cosmology. For example, Big Bang, such a crucial concept in cosmology. The Big Bang, the concept of Big Bang was ahead of experiment by about 40 years, because it was formulated in 1927 by Abbé Lemaître in an obscure journal. I mean, nobody knew about this article. It had to be translated into English, and unfortunately, one part, an important part, was missing. I think you know the story. I will not come back to this. And when was it really revived and established? In 1965, with the discovery of the microwave background. Because this is really what turned cosmology and Big Bang cosmology into something different from a hobby. You said it very nicely. I think Lando said that cosmology, before the discovery of Big Bang, cosmology is always false, but never in doubt. I think it's a very famous... He's supposed to have said that.
Often wrong, but never in, doubt. Right?
So I think we cannot judge about the scientific character of a theory if it's ahead or lagging behind. I think also that I agree that a theory should be eventually confirmed. But maybe we are facing now new kind of theories. I think what is important is also the spirit, the way it is formulated.
By the way, can I just make one? People were much more conservative about positing new entities back when I was a grad student. I remember my advisor told me to come up with some model to explain such and such a thing, and my model had a new particle, some heavy lepton, and I felt rather embarrassed that I was proposing the existence of several new particles. So this was pretty radical back then to propose new particles. And then very soon, now people, you know, then people started talking about extra dimensions and all sorts of crazy stuff. And now you propose models with hundreds of new particles, and nobody blushes, nobody feels embarrassed. I remember back in 84, there was the Inner Space, Outer Space Conference. And people were talking about, it was Kaluza-Klein, it was before a superstring revolution. And I had a model with 40 space-time dimensions. And Rocky Cold gave an award. They had a banquet, and at the banquet they were giving awards. Joke awards, and they gave an award for the paper with the most dimensions. And thank God, I won't say his name because he was deeply humiliated by this, but a very well-known physicist, an eminent physicist, fortunately had a paper with 560 dimensions, and he won first prize, and I only won second. And
I was
happy that he had 560. All bets are off now.
So the point is sometimes the guiding principle should be consistency and a theory that works and is mathematically reasonable. And these numbers, as the number of dimensions and so on, is fine as long as the theory is mathematically consistent. I think it's very important to work either on theories that are, let's say, way off, but they're really mathematically consistent, or theories that are closer, but perhaps not so mathematically consistent, but they give some reasonable experiments. And I think both approaches are reasonable. I mean, for example, the theory of inflation. So it predicts reasonably many things, and it leaves some questions unanswered, and, well, that's fine, but it is progress. On the other hand, we have string theory, which has all this consistency and beautiful formulas and so on, but we haven't a concrete prediction for quantum gravity in our real world. But I think both things are useful.
And if I may still mention a sort of a third leg upon which we are standing, we have theory, we have experiment and great advances, but also there at the background there is technology that's really driving the experiments. And let me just mention something that I was told some years ago. There was a guy whose name I have now forgotten, an American, an old guy who was one of the pioneers of observing the cosmic microwave background, did that already in the 50s, perhaps somebody can remember the name. But he was showing a graph of the sensitivity of the instruments. And that sensitivity had increased from the 50s 10 orders of magnitude. And that, he said, that why we were so why cosmology has advanced so much. The reason is that we had so bad detectors in the early days.
And it's worth mentioning that the same is happening now in dark matter searches. That basically every 3 years, an order of magnitude is improved. So within a decade, they improve sensitivity by three orders of magnitude. And they've been doing it for decades already and supposed to go further. So they've basically reached the same level of progress. Same is happening in gravitational wave searches and so on. But let me step back. Obviously, here on the panel, we have theorists, and that sort of reflects the mood, the opinions. So let me take, in some sense, the role of an experimentalist and insist. Physics is an experimental science. In the past, we could test a theory in and out by measuring basically everything it predicted. We've now conceded that so long as we get some sort of hint or partial evidence, we'll be already happy. We are heading into the situation when we may have no smoking guns whatsoever. Just basically, if you can produce a theory which can make any predictions which can in principle ever be confirmed, then we would already consider it a physical theory. I agree we need technological progress. Somebody estimated that if we wanted to if we wanted to reach the energy of grand unified scale, then the collider would have to be of the galactic size, which is certainly not quite feasible in any time soon.
I have been told that it should be the size of the universe, so if it would That's not fit in the universe, but if you start building now, eventually it will fit.
We had a talk today of using the universe as an example.
Well, let me come back to insisting that physics is an experimental science, and if we want to sell to the outside world that your theory, which makes perhaps one remote prediction out which can agree with measurement out of many other zillions of theories. Is this science? Is this experimental science? Or is it, let's call it, theoretical physics or theoretical theory?
Let me start with a positive note. I mean, certainly if you look at the recent history of cosmology, there is no sign of that. I mean, we have been moving forward very rapidly. New observations, new shocking observations like the acceleration, new wonderful observations like Bicep 2, and that was a great a detector. It did not observe what we initially hoped it would have observed, but nevertheless, seeing the B-mode polarization was an achievement. So I think there are lots of new data that's been coming steadily now for many, many years, and clearly there are many new experiments in the planning stage, in the building stage. So I see no reason for the kind of a despair that you are perhaps hinting at.
I'm just expressing the view of, I think, a very large number or fraction of physicists, more on the experimental side, but not necessarily, who have every right to insist that physics as experimental science can only deal with theories which can be experimentally tested.
Well, physics is not experimental science, it is empirical science, and that's the difference. Empirical means that you make experiments, observations. I think we should speak about observations in cosmology, and then we have theoretical explanations. And I think we are doing fine.
What happens if you have something and only one kind of coherent theory is, after decades and decades, only one coherent theory is ever formulated that would seem to explain a phenomenon? Isn't that some sort of, I mean, maybe sometimes you have five or six theories or ideas to choose between, but how many ways are there to solve the horizon problem, other than inflation?
In some sense, that's very worrisome, I would say, because you want to build this, you assume, if I'm not sort of changing the meaning of what you said, you want to build this enormous mathematical, theoretical edifice which would be self-consistent, beautiful, full of symmetries, whatever else. And on the basis of this, you would say, because it's so self-consistent, so beautiful, it must be right.
Nobody here said that. Not a single person on this panel said that. And so yeah, you're putting up the last few questions. You're putting up straw men, Leszek. I really reject the premises of these questions.
Oh, really?
I wouldn't say that, but take the following thing. I was reading a book recently by some lay person, and he was saying it's an amazing fine-tuning problem that the charge of the electron is exactly opposite to the charge of the proton. And in fact, we know that that's true to something like, we know that to about 17 decimal places. There's very good limits because neutrons and the neutral. But I don't think very many particle physicists lie awake at night worrying about why that is true, because we have a very good explanation based on grand unified symmetry, say the tracelessness of the generators of SU5. Now, we don't know that SU5, no one's going to win a Nobel Prize for SU5, but I think most particle physicists feel that there's something about that some of the mathematics of that almost has to be true, and it explains this thing that otherwise would be a remarkable thing. I mean, this author was also saying, isn't it amazing that there are three colors of quark and the quark charges are multiples of a third? Well, yes, but if we didn't have grand unified theories, that would seem like an astonishing. So I think even if we never confirm grand unified theories by seeing proton decay, I think a lot of people would feel that there's something, that they have elements in them that do explain certain puzzles. So maybe I'm coming close to what you say. It's such a beautiful explanation of the charge assignments of the particles that some aspect of it almost certainly have to be true, I would say.
So I've taken the sort of position of a devil's advocate to inject an opposing view, which is actually shared by many people. But on the other hand, I certainly agree that new ideas, new concepts that have come up with the studies of the early universe, of the whole universe, of unified theory, are very interesting. Perhaps one of the most interesting ideas that have come up in recent years is the holographic principle, that of the holographic principle that somehow has not been mentioned yet openly. Juan, could you perhaps comment on that, explain it maybe in briefly what it is to us, and then what it means, what it means to us, what's going to mean?
So the idea is that you can describe physics within some region by a theory that has a number of qubits that is proportional to the area of the region. So that's in general, roughly speaking. There is a precise relationship, which is the gauge gravity duality, which describes physics within certain spacetimes. There are spacetimes which are not cosmological. There are spacetimes which have a time asymptotic time translation symmetry. Physics in those spacetimes is equivalent to an ordinary quantum mechanical theory. So some theory which is governed by ordinary, could be relativistic quantum field theory, or it could even be ordinary quantum mechanics of some matrices. So what this is saying is that, well, space-time is emergent. It gives exact descriptions of these space-times. You can address some issues of black holes, at least that's seen from the outside. It's a tool to study quantum gravity. And I think it shows that string theory also is... this was found using string theory. And in some sense, it's part of what we model now call string theory, even in cases where there are no obvious strings lying around. I don't know if we want... I should expand more or not.
Any questions from that?
Concept has been mentioned by David is the Big Bang, the moment of Big Bang, the initial singularity. And somehow, so far, we've not really dwelt too much on that. But what was the Big Bang? Can we try to attempt to, can we attempt to try to answer this question scientifically? People have tried, right? Either to get rid of it, Hawking's boundless universe with no boundary conditions, or to accommodate it, bouncing universes, for example. But can we talk about the Big Bang, the singularity of the Big Bang in scientific terms in the first place? What do you think?
So I think the practical cosmologist would call Big Bang reheating after inflation. And what happened before that, I mean, that's somewhere in this quantum messy whatever. We don't know whether there was a past singularity or not, I mean, because we don't understand the quantum theory. But for practical people, Big Bang, the hot Big Bang that started at reheating, and that's it. That's very...
But the question was about the initial singularity. What is...
But is there one? We don't know.
Well, I mean, general relativity says that there is one, and it's telling us that current theories are not good enough. We need a new theory, and I think this is the best motivation for developing a theory of quantum gravity. I mean, a theory of quantum gravity should explain in a clear way how this singularity is resolved, or how we should think about the singularity. Mm. Even if this theory made no other prediction, I think understanding this in a rational way would be good enough.
Yeah, I agree.
Unfortunately, string theory is not yet up to the task to do this. Hopefully it will be. And some theories have taken a long time. I mean, sometimes people say, oh, you guys, string theories, you've been doing this for 40 years. I mean, what? But I remind you that there are some problems, and even problems which where you could do experiments, like superconductivity. So here's a phenomenon, you could do experiments, you have your lab, you do millions of experiments, and the theory was not developed for 50 years. So it took 50 years to develop the right theory for superconductivity. So give us a little break. And let us.
I mean, also you had QCD. QCD was developed in the early 70s, but before they could actually calculate the proton mass to the Rho meson mass ratio, that took decades. So
I think on the issue of bouncing, I mean, first of all, Juan, I mean, once we allow for things like inflation, it's not so clear whether general relativity really predicts a Big Bang. I mean, it gets the theorems are not very rigorous, but there's a recent argument by Aaron Wall that basically generalized Penrose's singularity theorem. So these original GR theorems, general relativity theorems, they're really theorems. You take a theory and you assume something about the matter in it, and it shows that there has to be an initial singularity. There has to be a Big Bang. The only problem is that what you assume about the matter in it isn't always true. What Aaron did was replace this with another assumption that many find very plausible, which is the second law of thermodynamics, or a generalized form of it. And he showed that in certain settings, for a universe which is infinite in size, that rules out bounces. It rules out the possibility that you just go through a minimum size and then get larger again. I think it's an incredibly interesting result. Of course, there are assumptions involved, and not all cases are covered. But it shows that, you know, we might uncover new tools to try to get at this fascinating question.
Yes. So I received some questions from the participants, and I would like to read one or two from the one who is not here tonight because he had to leave. And he refers to the idea that is sometimes mentioned that the universe created itself out of nothing. He said, isn't the statement that the universe can create itself or be created out of nothing somewhat irrational? I think he was quite polite in stating it this way, somewhat irrational. Can we consider this kind of idea remotely scientific? See?
Well, it depends on what you mean by nothing.
Can you elaborate?
No, I mean, there are very beautiful ideas about the universe, you know, the beginning of the universe being a quantum fluctuation. It depends what you mean. First of all, what do you mean by saying it started from nothing? You say there was a time at which there was nothing, and then there was a later time at which there was something. No, that doesn't make any sense, because if there's no universe, there's no time. I think what this saying the universe started from nothing basically is simply saying that the universe had a beginning, basically. It's not past eternal, that's all.
I actually don't think it matters at all what nothing means. It matters what the theory predicts. And if there's anything characteristic it predicts, and in this case, as Juan already pointed out, it predicts a universe that is totally different from the one we see. So I think it is science, it's not irrational, but it also turns out to be wrong.
Honestly, if it is philosophical, nothing means simply nothing, not even vacuum. There couldn't be even nothing, because if there is nothing, you cannot even create a concept of nothing. Right?
Suppose, forget all this quantum gravity stuff. Suppose the universe goes back and there's a T equals zero. Then how's that different from the universe starting from nothing? I mean, there's a T equals zero. There's no such thing as T less than zero. And maybe a T equals zero, the size of the universe is zero. I mean, so it started from zero size and grew. I mean.
And it could well be that it's often called the philosophical nothing, but that these are just words, and they mean nothing. and it could well be that the world is such that such a thing cannot exist. I mean, we can't know, but certainly I don't think one should take that sort of a talk seriously.
Nothing cannot exist. Philosophical nothing cannot exist, because if there are words, there is already something.
No, well, it does not mean anything, so that's...
So, another question from the same person is, isn't contemporary physics and cosmology somewhat irrational, in quotes? One means paradigms, hypotheses, like, say, eternal inflation, or inflation in general, dark matter, dark energy, superparticles, superstrings, landscapes, and so on. Aren't these notions based on the scientists, on what the scientists believe, on the scientists' belief? We use the words belief a few times here during this discussion. How much belief do we reject into our considerations?
Well, I think you have to believe that your theories have some chance to be correct. And then you work on these theories. And you don't necessarily always work on the same theories. We might work on contradictory theories. And that's fine. So, I mean, scientists don't have to be consistent. Only theorists have to be consistent. But you have to believe it. They have some chance of being correct. So, in that sense.
I mean, is it making a distinction between believing something and knowing something? Because, I mean, I believe that I have a nose on my face. But, of course... We don't really know anything with absolute certainty. That could all be some illusion that somehow. But I think we can be as certain of some things in science as we are that we have noses on our face. I mean, I don't think anybody's in doubt that oxygen nuclei, you know, that oxygen atoms have 8 electrons in them and things like that. I mean, some people say, well, science is never certain about anything. Everything could be revised. That's kind of BS, actually. I mean, nobody thinks that we're going to revise our theories and find out that the moon is really made of green cheese, or that the moon is really only, you know, 10,000 miles away, or that really we've been wrong about water being H2O all this time. The fact is, there are a lot of things that we believe to be true in science with enormous confidence, as confident as we are about anything in our everyday life.
Okay, as we're wrapping up, let me come back to this issue. What was the Big Bang? And let me put it in the context. Stephen Hawking once reported that he was at a meeting in the Vatican. I don't remember exactly what the circumstances were. Was it a scientific meeting, or was it something except... He mentioned that John Paul II was there, and he praised scientists for their effort to understand the world around us, he said, but he warned not to touch the act of creation. I'm just taking it out of memory, so I may be changing some words. But then Hawking commented in that context that he didn't want to tell the Pope that with his scientific work, with his no boundary condition, approach, no boundary approach, he was actually doing just that, trying to touch the act of creation. But what I found amusing in the statement is that there was Stephen was implicitly assuming that the Big Bang was the act of creation by saying that. So was the Big Bang possibly the act of creation?
Well, let me say something, since I write about religion and science. To traditional theology, Christian theology, creation was not an event that happened a long time ago. And that maybe a good analogy is consider a symphony. The act of creation is not something that happened with the first note. It only applies to the first note or the first bar of the symphony. The creation of the symphony is the conceiving of the whole symphony with all of its notes and everything. And that's different from how the symphony begins. There's no reason, or a book. The creation of the book is the conceiving of a novel, is the conceiving of the novel in the mind of its author. It's not something that just refers to the first words or sentences of the novel. Is there any reason theologically, from the point of view of, say, the Catholic Church, why the Big Bang would not be a natural event? No, it could be, it should, it actually, one would expect it to be a perfectly natural event in the sense that it obeyed the laws of physics. In the same way, you expect the first words of a novel to obey the laws of grammar, just like all the other sentences in the novel. So it's a kind of a red herring. It's not, it's because people don't understand what creation means. The Big Bang is not the moment of creation. The Big Bang is just how the universe started.
Any other comments or answers to try attempts to answer the question? What was the Big Bang? Was it an act of creation?
Nothing we're talking about has any significance theologically.
Well, it is a fact that in physics we don't know how to describe the very beginning of the Big Bang, the very beginning of the universe, so we need a theory to do that.
But if we found the theory, that would be fine. I mean, why wouldn't the first events of the universe obey the same laws as all the other events? Perfectly fine.
Kari?
Well, yes. I think maybe sometimes people, especially lay people, so mix these notions of beginning. And in some sense, if you, the beginning is no mystery. The only mystery really that there is that why can't we only travel forward in time?
Yeah, that's rather, where I was going to.
Rather than backward. I mean, beginning is just a point on the manifold. Like a North Pole is just a point, and the question is, why do we have always move sort of a run southwards?
I agree. We haven't even touched on what is time, and the arrow of time. So,
It is running out.
To the people who are, is there a possibility superstring theory will answer the an arrow of time question?
You know, at the beginning of this discussion, I mentioned that we were probably finished quite early, we're already past 10, and I can see that there are still people, you must be all terribly tired, but there are still people who want to comment, ask questions. Yeah, please.
I just wanted to make a short historical comment about this, because I believe the word creation is very loaded, actually. We say beginning, then it's more scientific. I fully agree with what you said. And you know, historically, Lemaître was the first president of Académie des Sciences Pontificales. So I don't know the word pontifical attached to the Vatican. Okay? He was the first. Sorry?
In English, it's also pontifical.
Oh, very good. Wonderful. Wonderful. So even with my accent, I can. Okay, so he was the first president, and I think the Pope was not the one during the World War, the other
Pius
one. Yeah, and he was very fond of science, so this is why he founded this academy. And he made a speech in which he suggested, he hinted that nowadays science is able to confirm creation. And it seems that, from what I read, that Lemaître, who was himself a priest, felt very, very, very uneasy with that thought. He didn't like that. He didn't like that at all. He always said, my fate is my fate and my science is my science. So it's very interesting because you were just mentioning...
He was worried because the Pope at that time was extremely enthusiastic about the Big Bang Theory. And Lemaître was worried that it might turn out to be wrong. I mean, he thought the Pope was going way out on a limb.
This is certainly true, but don't forget that he was himself the proponent of a Big Bang. So it's not that he thought it was crazy, but I think he really wanted to draw a clear line between fate and science.
Let me ask you, thank you very much. Let me ask you, are there any other last sort of final comments, questions? There is one in the back, right? We should wrap up, but...
So it seems like the background model is consistent, so with creation and without creation, without a creator. But it seems like when you look at perturbations, for example, prayer is inconsistent. For example, I don't think it propagates at the speed of light.
Can you repeat? What is inconsistent?
Prayer. So so the background model is consistent, but the perturbations aren't, right? I would say the perturbations are prayer.
Okay. Done quite.
Could you hear properly?
Prayer.
Like making a prayer. Like, so you were talking about creation and creationism, right? You said at the beginning of the Big Bang, is it consistent with physics? Like a creation, and you said like the first note in a symphony. And I'm saying the background model is consistent with physics, but maybe you continue with like, I called it.
I think we've now transcended the competence of this panel.
We should draw a veil of ignorance over this.
All right. Any other questions, comments? Okay, in the front, this one. Enrico.
A student of mine, when I talked about... A student of mine, when I talk about the Big Bang and about the possibility of multiverse, asked me a question. What has exploded? The creator? Or the creator has created a bomb and the bomb exploded? And if we talk about the multiverse, is the creator a pyroman? He likes to create great bombs and the bombs explode. You see that among students there are different mentalities, but I was stupefied what I have to answer. So it is humoristic.
So in the case of the multiverse, it's actually a well-understood physical process, which is similar to phase transitions. And so it really takes a lot of the mystique out of the formation.
Maybe the answer to the student is that he should choose some other field than physics.
All right, so unless there are any urgent questions, looks like there is one quite urgent. Let's try to finish it. So this will be the last one there, and then we'll wrap up because it's really past the time. Now, I never expected this would last so long, and that you would last so long here in this audience.
I want to ask, do you have an opinion about the concept of us living in some kind of computer simulation?
Matrix universe.
I don't exactly mean computer simulation, but something. The computer simulation is the best describing, world of... It's the best describing, world we can say about it, So, do you have an opinion?
Who wants to answer this? Make a...
At least there are lots of bugs, so... So maybe that's an indication, a hint.
All right, I think we should... So does anyone want to? I think we should just wrap up. And thank you for your questions, for your attention, for your patience with us. And I think my impression is that we There's still quite a few questions to consider for the next Cosmo, next several thousand, millions, zillions Cosmo meetings, perhaps. Thank you very much to all the panelists and to the audience.